to your 6 pounds of urea. Quick introduction, Frank Gouin, Professor Emeritus from the University of Maryland, longtime horticulture specialist when we used to call it the Department of Horticulture up on campus. You may have seen some articles by him. He's a regular contributor to the Bay Weekly, which is a community newspaper mostly over in Anne Arundel County, although I do see it sometimes in retail outlets here on the close to the Bay. And I see him referred to as the compost guru. So, you know, I'm real excited to get him today talking about blueberries. It's a crop that's gaining in interest from growers, and it seems that consumers are demanding more fresh blueberries as opposed to the frozen ones you can get in the store. If you notice from our agenda, Frank has two parts to his talk. We're going to have a short intermission after the first 45 minutes, and then we'll come back and continue his talk. So I'm real excited and glad to have Frank here talking with us today. So, Frank.
You know, that's a better introduction than what I got from the dean. He used to introduce me as King Shit. I became involved in composting in 1972. Up until 1970, composting was not a science. It was a hit-and-miss operation. The Clean Water Act of 1969, which prevented the dumping of sewage sludge into the oceans and streams and lakes, mandated that we develop other methods of disposing of sludge besides land application, which cannot be done during the winter months. USDA and EPA joined forces and developed what was known as a biological waste management laboratory at Beltsville. This came at the same time that Poland and Ireland stopped shipping peat moss to this country. It was their source of fuel for producing electricity for heating houses. And we were using 36,000 cubic yards of peat moss in the Washington, D.C., Baltimore area per year. It was being shipped here by ballast. So I started looking for alternate sources of organic matter, and I looked at many over the years. But when I was invited to Beltsville in 1972 to their open house, I saw a big pile of nice brown looking, smelling, nice earth looking. And it says, I want to work with this. My counterparts at Beltsville, Dr. Mark Cathy, didn't want to work with it because it was full of bad characters. But you have to understand, I'm a plumber's son. I emptied septic tanks and plumbed up sewers, so it didn't bother me. And therefore, I joined the team, and we became a team in which we extended composting. Last month, Anne Arundel County approved the composting of horse manure and restaurant waste. What a beautiful combination. We have a shortage of compost. We are importing compost from as far as Maine, and we still can't meet our demands. The whole science of composting is based on understanding carbon, nitrogen, carbon, phosphorus. We can compost, we are composting biosolids, sewage sludge, in 40 days. We can compost yard debris in 3 months. We know how to speed up the whole process. We know how to manage it. And therefore, composting facilities in Maryland, because of my becoming involved in it, I wrote the bill that mandates that yard debris can no longer go in landfills. And we established composting facilities on that bill. Yard debris doesn't belong in landfill, nor does horse manure or restaurant waste. You can compost anything that is organic. And I can brag and say that I have composted from New Brunswick, Canada to California. I've been involved in composting, including Disney World, where we set up the composting facility where back in the 80s and 90s, they were doing 100 tons a day of waste. So if you all visited Disney World, and rain from that time on, you all contributed to the landscape, because 85% of what is composted goes back and they don't buy any fertilizer. Composting is the ultimate in recycling, but it has to be done right. And if you're going to go into commercial composting in Maryland, you have to be certified. I used to teach a course in composting, better composting school. I taught it for 12 years, and it's still being taught, but not as often as we did then. But we had taught composting to people from pretty well all over the country, including Europe. So therefore, let's talk about getting started in composting. C is carbon. We are dealing with carbon. Sugars, starch, cellulose, hemicellulose. All components of paper and wood and plant tissues. And we are dealing with nitrogen. The organisms that do the compostings are bacteria, few of them, fungi, and actinomycetes. They need the nitrogen to build their bodies, because their bodies are mostly protein, and they need the nitrogen to reproduce. Carbon is a source of fuel. It's like when you put wood in the stove, it burns. You eat, you generate body heat. You multiply your cells. Microorganisms do the same thing. But they're different from us because they don't have eyeballs. So they can operate in the dark. But in order for them to operate, they need oxygen. They need oxygen. We say the book will tell you 5% oxygen, our air contains 21% oxygen. But we can go as low as 2% oxygen, but then it goes anaerobic and you get an odor. And when you have an odor, you are not composting, you are fermenting. And that is where the difference lies. Also, you need water. Dry leaves don't compost. Dry corn stalks don't compost, nor dry straw. You need at least 40%, better 50%, but you do not want to exceed 60% water. Over the years that I did, I worked with almost 30 years in composting. The Biological Waste Management Lab operated from 1969 until President Reagan took office. And he said, you solved the waste problem. We're shutting down the lab. But since I was with the University of Maryland, I took over the research at Maryland and continued the work and expanded it to compost garbage, crab waste, paper mill waste. It all can be composted by knowing this right here. Very important. Wood, sawdust, wood chip contains approximately a carbon nitrogen ratio of 800 to 600 to 1. It won't compost. That's why those piles of sawdust are still sitting there. The inside gets black as it starts to undergo fermentation. To compost, we look at 25 to 35 to 1. So therefore, what we do when we compost, we balance the amount of carbon to nitrogen. And when we balance the carbon to nitrogen in this ratio, and we provide oxygen from 5% to 21%, and we have less than 50 and 60% moisture, you compost. And in the process of composting, you develop heat. An active composting pile should have temperatures of at least 140 degrees. I have composted gelatin waste up in Worcester, Massachusetts. We had 200 degrees. They were so scared they brought in a fire truck. But it never exploded because we maintained the moisture content at 55%. The microorganisms are digesting the carbon, and in the process of digesting the carbon, the cell walls collapse and the nutrients are released. So therefore, now, when you can see what the problems we create, people are out putting ground up pallets or ground up wood chip under their plants. What happens? The microorganisms see that carbon and they go and they steal nitrogen from the soil to build their bodies, to reproduce, to eat that carbon. And therefore, the plants starve for nitrogen. Having been in Maryland, done compost work with the homeowners and the commercial nurseries, seeing this occur statewide and written about it many times, mulching is a disaster, especially when you're using these organics. I wrote an article called "Too Mulch of a Good Thing." Therefore, understanding this relationship between carbon and nitrogen and being able to balance it at a point where now at between 25 to 35 to 1, and we do that with laboratory tests, we can now compost in 40 days. But it takes another 40 days for the material to stabilize. Now, when we are working with composting, right this time of the year, it's cold. And if you have a little compost pile at home, it's not doing anything. Therefore, volume becomes a factor. I had to go to Sudbury, Ontario one time. They were having trouble with composting their sewer sludge. When I got up there, I talked to them over the telephone, told them I thought what I suspected they were doing wrong. So by the time I got up there, they had corrected it. There was 3 feet of snow, but no snow at all on the piles of composting outside. It was all melted. And the problem was they were not aerating. That pile, if it is too big, the center of it will go anaerobic. And when that occurs, you have alcohol and methane that is developed. And if the moisture content gets down below 40%, you have an explosion. There have been many compost fires because they don't pay attention to moisture. They don't pay attention to aeration. So therefore, to maintain aeration, you have two choices. You either control the size of the pile, making it no more than approximately 10 feet across and no more than 10 feet high, so that you get natural convection carrying air into it. As it heats, it rises. When we go commercially, you get the facilities. There's a facility outside of Baltimore that does 180 tons of sewage sludge a day. And it's all done by forcing air through the system. They have silos. They can push air up through, or they can suck air down through. And they have sensors that not only measure oxygen, they measure temperature. because the ideal temperature for composting is 150 degrees. At 150 degrees, you are breaking down materials at the most rapid rate possible. That is when the organisms are functioning at their maximum capacity. One of the products that comes out of the composting facility is carbon dioxide. And people tell me, well, you're contributing to the greenhouse gas problem. No, that would occur naturally out there. I'm just speeding up the process. And again, the CO2 that is coming out of this can be utilized by plants, as compared to the CO2 that we generate when we burn fossil fuels, because the CO2 from fossil fuels has an isotope, isotope 13, which enlarges it and cannot be absorbed by plants, and therefore that's why it is accumulating in the stratosphere. There's a laboratory in Mauna Loa, the biggest mountain in Hawaii, whose function it is to measure that CO2 level. And there's an isotope, and that's how they measure it. But the CO2 we generate comes from the oxygen going in, from the carbon being burnt up by the microorganisms, and as a result, CO2 comes out as well as heat. The heat generated from composting has actually been used by greenhouses to heat greenhouses. They lay pipes inside the composting pile, they suck air, they put a tube down the bottom, and they suck air through here to bring air into it, and the pipes are laid in here, water is run through it, and they run into greenhouses. There's a place outside of Philadelphia that I worked with that heat up their greenhouse. Then they take the compost and mix it in their potting soil, and they bring in a new patch in the fall of the year. So composting is a science. It's a science that requires a lab test to determine what is the carbon ratio and the nitrogen ratio, and then you blend. When I worked on Prince Edward Island and composting their waste, Prince Edward Island has no more dumping area. They filled up all their valleys, so they went to composting. When I went there, I knew what was produced in potatoes. They had a complete list of all their waste materials. And by punching in data, I was able to develop a recipe that they follow, and they still follow. They compost their garbage, their potato waste, lobster waste, herring waste is all composted and being recycled there on the island. The science is very clear, but the problem is that people are trying to cut short and they have problems. That's why when we wrote the bill on composting, that we take and we have a certified program operated by a certified manager who are equipped to measure oxygen, moisture. Over the years, I tested a lot of instruments that measure moisture, but this hand is the closest one that has the greatest accuracy. So if you want to know how much moisture there is in your compost pile, what you do is that you take a paper sponge, and when I taught the course, I did this regularly. Soak that paper sponge and squeeze as much water as you can out of it, and then in your left hand, feel of it. That is 50% moisture. If you squeeze it and water comes out and drips off the end of your elbow, you're above 60%. If it feels dry, you're below 40%. So therefore, it is very important that when you are composting, so that you avoid odors, because when you go anaerobic, you develop odors. Rotten egg, very sulfury smell, those are all odors. The nose knows. One time when I was working with Beltsville, we received a shipment of undigested, up until then we've been working with digested biosolids from Blue Plains. They didn't tell us they brought in a truckload of undigested, raw. We didn't know it. We treated it. The BW Parkway runs within a half a mile of their composting site. By 5 o'clock that evening, we were shut down. The judges, the nose knows. And that is when we developed a whole new system of composting where we use a principle that is here, excepting we did it and putting a pipe underneath it and pulling air through it. In the wintertime, to make sure our piles are composted, we put about a 10-inch blanket of compost over the top as a thermal blanket. And we maintain heat through the whole system all winter long. We control the airflow by sucking air. And then we scrub the air with compost so there's no odor. Cellulose, when you have a good compost media, that brown material that you see in the compost pile are lignins. Lignins are very difficult to break down. They're very difficult. That's why they last in the ground. When you plow a lignin in the ground, it maintains, reduces the bulk density of soil, and it makes them much, much more friable. Cellulose and hemicellulose are the materials we have to get rid of and the carbon materials that are there. And we do that by destroying them. We destroy them with the microorganisms that I found in the soil out there. All the actinomycetes and the fungi that do the composting are right there in the soil. To speed up the whole process, you take compost from an active pile and you introduce it into your new blend. And when we do composting of biosolids on yard debris, that is exactly what we do. We add 10% of old compost, freshly old compost, freshly made, to it, and the process within 24 hours, temperatures will rise. Within 48 hours, you will achieve 140 to 150 degrees. So therefore, the inoculum is there. How effective is composting in destroying? Very effective. I worked at Aberdeen Proving Ground where the soils were contaminated with PCBs. We used yard debris from Aberdeen area. We used gunpowder from World War I as a source of nitrogen, and we introduced 10% contaminated soil into the composting systems. And 60 days later, we could not find any PCBs. We destroyed it. Up until then, they were burning it, using fossil fuel to burn them to destroy them. I worked with the Gladfelter Paper Company. They were producing a sludge from paper mill manufacturing that contains dioxins. I reviewed some research out of Michigan that said they had isolated an organism that destroyed dioxins in the composting process. At that same time, I was working with Delaware with their composting sludge and garbage, and they had dioxins. So we brought in a truckload of Michigan compost and introduced it into the piles, and within 30 days, we destroyed dioxins. These are biological systems that we don't know how great Mother Nature is until you start finding these different concepts. Now, many people are getting into wood chip. There's a tremendous difference in wood chip from conifers versus hardwoods. And this is what you have to be aware of, because it is a rather, it's a system that creeps up on you slowly, and that is the element manganese. Hardwoods contain manganese absorbers. Conifers will absorb manganese, but they also have a material called polyflavonoids that prevent that manganese from becoming available. So given a choice of composting wood waste, go to conifers. Loblolly pine, you have lots of it. Wood chip. Double shredded hardwood bark mulch is one of the biggest problems that we have and cause, and the homeowners love it because it's nice and black and they put it on. It controls weeds and dentists has to control their plants. You look at azaleas, the leaves are turning red and yellow and the leaves are getting smaller, and you look at this soil test results and manganese levels are sky high. If that double shredded hardwood bark mulch was composted, most of the manganese would stay down where the compost was made. What they would be bringing back would be a lower level, but it would still accumulate. Manganese is a big problem. I have seen levels of it in homeowners' soil samples and in the nursery where they were using it in azaleas that nothing could grow in it. And you can't get rid of it. It won't go away. It binds the iron. Plant can't take up iron because of it. And as a result, you have these crazy symptoms, and there's a gradual buildup. I've seen levels of it at 300 and 400 pounds to the acre, where the ground is sterile. Nothing will grow. Therefore, if you are using mulches, have your manganese analysis made. Make sure that your manganese is always lower than your iron, copper, and zinc levels in the soil. Because once it gets higher, you start having some light problems, and as it gets higher and higher, the problem becomes much more visible. I've covered the entire state. I've seen a lot of this. And therefore, and a lot of it came as a result, in my understanding of it, as I understood composting better, having worked in it.
Can you correct the manganese problem?
You dig out the soil and you replace it. I've never found any way to get rid of it. There's a school for these captains that do the large ships over in St. Mary's County. Their entrance had roses. They kept replacing the roses, and the roses kept dying. So I finally looked at it. I could tell they were using double shredded hardwood bark mulch. And the whole thing, levels were over 300 pounds to the acre.
Does the manganese still build up if you burn the hardwood first?
It's going to build up where you put it.
Where you burn it?
Well, if you compost it there and take your mulch and put it over there, you're getting ripped. You're leaving most of your manganese here. No, it just accumulates in the surface. It doesn't leach.
To what depth?
Pardon?
To what depth?
I've seen it go down approximately 3 to 4 inches.
So don't try to plant where you do your composting?
That's right. And azaleas and blueberries are all shallow rooted. My man Bob Black at Catoctin Mountain Orchard was using the sawdust coming out of where they raise rats for the laboratory, and his blueberries all died. His manganese level were way up high. Bob Rouse right there is very much aware of that.
So you only have to dig out 4 inches to get rid of it. It's not like you're digging out 3 feet. It's kind of a plus.
You do 4 inches on an acre of land, you've moved a lot of soil. And what you going to do with it after you dug it out?
Dump it in the ocean.
Dump it in the ocean. You ought to get 40 lashes with a wet noodle. How am I doing?
You good. You got 15 left.
Okay.
Do you want that 30-day stabilization period to be away from it then, you know?
No, well, on the stabilization, after you compost, you have almost 0% nitrogen left in there. What's happening, microorganisms don't live very long. They die, but they recycle. And as long as they're recycling, your compost will have very low level of nitrogen. That's how we measure maturity in compost, is there ammonia and the nitrate available.
Like mushroom compost is very low.
Mushroom composting is not composted. I worked with mushroom composting out of Pennsylvania. They were selling it to greenhouses, and the material that plants died.
Yeah.
There were two reasons. One, the soluble salt level was extremely high, and the other one, that the carbon-nitrogen ratio was 70 to 1. Carbon-nitrogen ratio when compost is mature should be around 19 to 15 to 1. Now it is releasing.
So you just want to add urea to mushroom compost?
That's what the problem was. They were adding urea, and we had salt sickles underneath the beds. And that was going into the compost being sold to nurseries. You raise the soluble salt level. So therefore, I had to go work with the mushroom growers to teach them to compost it before they sold it to the greenhouse people.
What's acceptable soluble salt on compost?
Pardon?
What's acceptable soluble salt level on compost?
Accepted soluble salt, you never use compost straight. You always dilute it. Right now, most of our compost will come in at approximately 7 to about 5 millimoles per centimeter. So we can use up to approximately 1/4 to 1/3 by volume in a potting mix. When you're adding it to soil, because soil has a higher exchange capacity, has a higher soil exchange capacity, we can go approximately 4 to 5 cubic yards per 1,000 square feet. Or 400 tons to the acre. That's about 4 cubic yards, about a 1-inch thick layer incorporated into the upper 6 inches of soil. And that is a good deal. That's a good bit of compost, and you'll get tremendous results. In sandier soils, we can go higher, but we go down deeper. Now, when I first started working with compost, I started working with forest seedlings. I set up a research project where I could study the effects of how long will a single application of compost show the effects on growth. 7 to 8 years. One application. I could drive by and I could tell, and then we pull samples out and we could see the residual properties of compost. Lignins are very slow to break down, and as they break down, they continue to release nutrients. The whole process of composting. Now, there are advantages to compost. My friend Harry Hoyting at Ohio State saw some of my research when I was working with trying to eliminate the need to drench poinsettias. Back in the 70s, if you grew a poinsettia plant, you had to drench it every 2 weeks with Dexon terichlor, very highly toxic fungus, soil fungicides. But I discovered my work at the State Forest Nursery that we had wiped out diseases on black walnut, because the nursery had to stop growing black walnut because the plants would die of black shank. So I took the work into the greenhouse. We started adding 25% to 30% to 35% to a potting mix, and pretty soon we were growing poinsettias without any fungicides. Now, Paul Ecke was a king of Ecke, a ranch, and he said, I was a curse to the industry. One of my graduate students is now running Paul Ecke Ranch. You know what's going into the potting mix. But compost also has natural occurring fungicides, especially if it is made with wood products. Dr. Hoyting found that if the wood produces three sulfur-related fungicides, which increase the disease suppression properties, Pythium rhizoctonia are very sensitive to compost. And I'll show you what happens in composting.
I
If you were to plot composting, you set up with ambient air temperature, you get to about 140. Within days, your temperatures go up this way. And approximately 10 days over here, you're just about reached this peak. And you can literally watch the piles shrink. Yard debris will shrink 70%. Yard debris, leaves and grass clippings. And when we do grass clippings, we do 2-to-1. 2 parts leaves, 1 part grass clippings. But now I've found out we're doing 1-to-1. And we get faster composting. At this point up here, you've gotten rid of nearly all of your diseases that a soil will have, that I've found. But if you are composting sewer sludge, you're not going to eliminate the seeds, because cherry tomatoes, I have to go up to 150 degrees to get rid of those bloody things. And when we were composting by turning the piles, we were getting 140. But once we went to aerated pile, where we're sucking air down through the piles, we went up to 150, and I killed my tomato seeds. My first research plots, I had more tomato plants than I had crabgrass. But after we went and changed the system, okay, now what is happening? Well, as the temperatures start to come back down again, you have invasion of beneficial organisms. Now, when they tried to put this on the bag of the advantages, they said, well, you're not introducing them. How do you know we're there? We know they're there because they're coming in, and we can find them in the pile. But there are beneficial organisms, the disease-causing organisms have been wiped out on the temperatures going up. But the beneficial organisms come back in again, as do the fungicides, three natural occurring fungicides that develop during the composting process. Yeah, Bill?
Frank, when you get to the 150, how much of a holding time do you need at that temperature, or is it just happens right away?
Well, when we're composting biosolids, we require 150 degrees for 5 consecutive days. In the piles, we see it go to 10 to 15 days. When we're doing biosolids, we have what PFRP, process further to reduce pathogens, to control salmonella, typhoid, and diphtheria. And therefore, the composting process does. At 140, we had to go 10 days. When I started working with composting, I was condemned by many people saying I was spreading AIDS. But AIDS never made it down to the wastewater treatment plant. I was assured of that. And we've never found it in any of the compost piles. But we have beneficial organisms, and those beneficial organisms will remain in compost for just about a year, or unless you let it get dry. And if you let the compost go dry, now I call it based on, I used to have lots of compost samples all over my lab. And one day I decided, I wonder how active some of this is. It was 1 year old, 2 years old, powder dry. I had to put it in water and let it sit and get moist for about a month before the microorganism reactivated. But when it goes dry, the beneficial organisms die out. I call it lab compost.
Did you have to add oxygen so they would?
No. Not thick enough layer. Oxygen will penetrate. I didn't have big piles, I just had samples. But the whole science of composting is fabulous. I get, as you can tell, I get excited when I'm about to talk about this. Even my kids. They would invite their friends over to dinner, and the kids wouldn't want to eat. I said, oh, go ahead and eat it. It'll come out brown. We'll compost it. But when we have, to really appreciate Mother Nature, you will appreciate it when you work with the compost, because you can see the biological systems that are involved in this process. And when you can destroy PCBs and dioxins, which up until then were being destroyed by burning fossil fuel and putting into the atmosphere, Mother Nature is marvelous. Just that here in composting, we have learned how to accelerate those microorganisms so that they are functioning at their maximum capacity 24 hours a day. And you do that by balancing the carbon-nitrogen ratio. You get that information from a lab. We used to, we had wrote a book, On-Farm Composting Handbook, was printed by Cornell. And in there we had a computer model, computer disk, that you took all your feedstocks, you printed them out, and plugged them in there, and it would tell you what to blend to get the 50% moisture, the carbon-nitrogen ratio, 25 to 35 to 1, and you went. And with that type of information, we composted lots of stuff. When I worked at composting your garbage, I had a totally different, I had to work on a carbon-phosphorus ratio. And the carbon-phosphorus ratio, because it was all mostly paper, was approximately 200 to 300 to 1 phosphorus requirement for carbon. But with leaves, manure, the phosphorus is there. The phosphorus is needed to the transfer of energy. It dawned on me at 3 o'clock one morning while I was living in Deal. I couldn't figure out why my composting would start and stop, start and stop. Finally, at 3 o'clock in the morning, I woke up and it says, phosphorus, energy transfer. I get up, drove down to College Park, set up an experiment. By noon, I had my answer. Then I started working with 200 to 300 to 1, and we solved that problem. The post office is the one that got me to do that because they had so much junk mail, they didn't know what to do with it, so they decided they would compost it.
Intermission. Yeah. All right, we're going to take a short 15-minute break, and we'll come back with Dr. Gouin.